A lot of people today are looking at building new self-storage as a way to get in the self-storage business or to grow their self-storage business. Let me share with you five mistakes that we've made in developing self-storage. So if this is how you're going to enter the business or grow your business, at least these mistakes you'll know a little bit about. My name is Mark Helm. I'm the author of Creating Wealth Through Self-Storage, and I'm the creator of the Quick Start Academy. And what I do is I support the small investor who wants to get in the self-storage business or who wants to grow their self-storage business, strategically do so in a way that creates true wealth and a fulfilling career. And I'm recording this 2020 during the age of Corona, COVID-19. We're at the time in the summer where it's been spiking up again. People I know are coming down with it. So my invitation to you is to be very careful, stay safe, wear a mask, and don't pass it on to other people. And I hope you and your family are safe and well. But let's talk about five mistakes that I've made or we've made in the self-storage development process. I could have called this the 100 mistakes I've made, but nobody would watch and no one would read it. And most mistakes we make in development of self-storage are not fatal mistakes. A lot of the mistakes are things that we wish we'd done a little differently, but don't necessarily cost us a lot of time and money. I do want to share with you five things that we've done that I wish we hadn't done or wish we'd thought about differently. So I'm gonna call these the five mistakes we made in developing self-storage. And mistake number one, we talk about location, location, location all the time. But if you've been searching for a site in a particular market area where you know that self-storage is needed, self-storage today is a, quote, retail business. So we all start looking at retail sites. And it doesn't take long to see that it's really hard to make self-storage work with most retail property that's for sale. You know, most retail property will be developed by retailers. You know, Walgreens, for example, may be getting $170, $200 a square foot in sales, and they can afford to pay more for land. You know, in self-storage, a killer project is getting $20 or a little bit above $20 a square foot. Most projects are less or much less than that per square foot. So it doesn't take long as you're doing your site selection search to realize that most retail type land is out of the question. So we end up setting our sights for something lower and then end up settling. I invite you to change from retail location to high visibility location. You don't necessarily need, quote, retail land. What you need is land that's on a main thoroughfare with high traffic counts for that market area. And hold out till you get that. What you don't want to be is two or three turns off the main road because the land costs are better, or at the end of a cul-de-sac, even if it's a retail type location. We have one that's at the end of a cul-de-sac with centers and hotels around us, but the visibility is low. You want high visibility. The majority of our new leases today still come from, quote, drive-by. I'm talking 30% of new leases come from, quote, drive-by on the low end, up to close to 50 on the high end. And all that informs us is that people drive by our location all the time who live in that area, see it, and then when they have a need for storage, we're top of mind. They may use Google to get to us or some other way to find us, but we're top of mind because of our location. So location is still critical and a number one factor, and one many of us, after being frustrated and not being able to find the right site, will begin to lessen our expectations on. Don't do that. Mistake number two, and I don't know exactly how to call this, but it's not making the right compensations in our thinking and our development for the time involved in new construction. So we've had a lot of experience doing expansions and conversions, which are a quicker type project than ground up new construction. So let me give you an example. We approached this deal like we did most of our other deals. We got the land under control, then we got the feasibility report, then we got most or all of our construction numbers, then we got our, you know, we got our loan, we went to see if we could build it, what the process is, can we do it? Fortunately, we didn't have to zone the land. All we had to do was get the site permit and the building permit. So we felt comfortable closing on the project, which is the only way we could get it before we got the permits. And we did all the things that we have normally done in the past. What I didn't compensate for was the amount of time between deal formation and when we start renting. So we closed on the land, and as you can guess, it took a lot longer to get the site work and get the site disturbance permit. It took a lot more engineering costs than we anticipated, a lot more architectural renderings than we anticipated. The whole project took a lot longer to get approved and then get the building permits. Our initial contractors that we thought were going to start in the spring, they ended up going to another job, and it took longer to get there. The whole process took over a year and a half. And by the a year and a half later, by the time we're actually starting to lease, that submarket had changed considerably in the square feet per capita. So we did not adequately allow for and think through the amount of time it could take. When you're doing your due diligence on ground up construction, whatever time frames you get from the engineers or the contractor or the fabricators, add time to it. We didn't do that. Mistake number three, not having enough contingency in our budget. We put in a 10% contingency thinking we were fine. Contractors, you know, the construction manager felt good with that. Bank felt good with that. Sure wish we'd had more in there because of the amount of time it took. A lot of our pricing went up. And you always run into the unexpected things. And I sure wish we'd had something closer to a 15% contingency in that construction budget. So make sure you've got enough contingency to deal with the curveballs that will come at you in new construction, especially if this is your first one. A lot of the curveballs came in the form of site work and requirements that the municipality had that we didn't initially anticipate. Mistake number four, not phasing in as much as you can. One of the beauties of self-storage is, unless you're building a multi-story, single building, climate-controlled self-storage project, is that you can phase self-storage in very easily. Now, there's going to be a pull on you from the fabricators, the contractors, the subcontractors. All of these guys are going to be, or gals, are going to be pulling on you to build as much as you can right now because it's going to save you money. And perhaps it would save you some money. Just remember, those people are not servicing the debt on the project. You never want to be that far ahead of the market where you're servicing debt on a lot of empty units sitting around. So some of the decisions you're going to have to make are, do I pour all of the concrete pads for all of the buildings while the concrete truck is there? Do I go on and order the next building or two from the fabricator because steel costs are going to go up? Do I put up temporary fencing to make it secure because that's the only way I can rent parking, knowing that that fence is going to have to come down? Do we do the site work on phase two? As long as the site work crew's here, it's going to be cheaper to do it. Should we go on and get it done now? Those are the type of decisions you're going to be dealing with. My coaching is, as much as possible, phase your project in if you have debt on it. So you're not servicing debt on a lot of empty units sitting out there. At least if you are, you can tell yourself as you cut that check to the bank every month, well, at least I saved money. If you don't want to do that, just phase in as much as you can. Don't get too far ahead of the market. And the last mistake is, I'm going to call it over-engineered or overbuilt self-storage. Now, a lot of this is my personal opinion, but if I could, every self-storage facility I own would be nothing but a steel building on concrete pad with chain link fence. Why? Well, because I'm not going to get any more for a 10 by 10 in a building that's made out of block with shingled roof. Or I'm not going to get any more for a 10 by 10 because I've got decorative concrete block. Or because there is decorations in the wrought iron fence that faces the street. I always start with, I'm going to put up a steel building, chain link fence in the very basics, and then we make adjustments as we need to because of what the requirements are for that municipality. Now, the tendency is, and I've seen it a lot, especially on projects that we look at, is to overbuild and over-engineer. Most HVAC companies are going to overspec the amount of HVAC you need. Why? Well, because they're used to specing HVAC for office buildings, hotels, retail buildings, homes. You don't need that much in storage. You're not sitting in 72 degrees all day long. So, big mistake is to over-engineer, overbuild, spend more money than you need to. We're not creating a monument that future civilizations or future species are going to dig up and marvel at. We're interested in return on investment. The lower I can keep that initial investment, the higher my return. Because unless I can get more for a unit by adding these features, I'm going to not add them unless I have to get the approval. So the big mistake I see for a lot of people, especially on their first one, is overbuilding and over-engineering a self-storage facility. The beauty of self-storage is it's inexpensive to build. That's also one of the challenges to it. So those are the five mistakes that I've made that I want to share with you, hoping you can avoid some of those. Nothing is more fulfilling than having a vision and then seeing that vision materialize in the form of a storage facility. It's fulfilling, it's exciting, and it creates a whole new future and a whole new what's possible for you or you and your family. Avoid some of these mistakes. These were the costly mistakes for us. You will make mistakes. The goal is not to make costly mistakes or not to make fatal mistakes. Remember some of these mistakes we've made as you develop and get in or grow in this fantastic business of self-storage. It is the best business there is by far for the small investor. Just keep these in mind. Thank you very much. My name's Mark Helm. I'm the author of Creating Wealth Through Self-Storage, and I'm the creator of the Storage World Analyzer. That's the financial analysis modeling tool we use to run the numbers and the ROI on these new construction projects that we're looking at. If you're using Excel, great, but I invite you to really look at the analyzer. It can solve a lot of problems for you that you may have experienced in Excel. Creating Wealth Through Self-Storage.com, Storage World Analyzer tab, or go straight to StorageWorldAnalyzer.com. Thank you very much, and I look forward to being with you again next week.